Welcome to Facts TV News, where everything is true. JFF fined by FIFA for a bottle throwing incident. The Jamaica Football Federation, JFF, has been fined $170,000 by FIFA for a bottle throwing incident that took place near the end of the World Cup qualifying game against the United States at the National Stadium on November 16. The fine is to be paid within 30 days of notification of the present decision. The JFF said a plastic bottle was thrown from bleachers near the running track and the incident was reported to FIFA security officer on site. The federation appealed the decision, but FIFA subsequently responded that the appeal was inadmissible. In its appeal, the JFF expressed regret at the incident, pointed to its constant appeal to fans through different means not to throw objects as well as limitations on the sale of refreshments inside the stadium. Meanwhile, the JFF is reminding spectators that they must follow all outlined protocols once they are within the confines of the National Stadium on match day. It said another breach could threaten Jamaica's hope of hosting international games in the future. Community barber gunned down on Red Hills Road. A man was gunned down on Red Hills Road on Sunday. Reports from residents are that sometime after 4 p.m., the man was walking in his community when he was approached by men on motorbikes who opened fire on him. Residents say the deceased was a barber in the community who operated out of a popular shop in the area. Police are investigating the incident. Stop telling us when to go to bed, says Crawford to Holness. Opposition Senator Damian Crawford has pointed to studies which have suggested that curfews that are imposed to curtail the spread of COVID-19 are ineffective and, in fact, could backfire. Crawford raised the issue in the Senate on Friday as he made his contribution to the 2021-2022 State of the Nation debate. Since this government has been in power, this Prime Minister Andrew Holness has been telling people when to go to bed long before COVID. He was doing it with the state of emergency. He was doing it with ZOZO's Zones of Special Operation, and he seems to take great pleasure when it's been announced, go to your bed at 10, go to your bed at 8, go to your bed at 6, Crawford said to cynics from his fellow opposition senators. Continuing, Crawford noted that the research is saying that these early evening curfew for which we celebrate an additional hour when they are relaxed because we are so traumatized by it that every time he comes with a grand announcement, one more hour, we say yes, thank you, we rejoice, don't work. He is recommending that the government instead take action that is effective. Crawford pointed to what he said was the government's foolish action to tell operators of public passenger vehicles, including taxi drivers, that they must carry one passenger less than their license permits. What is recommended is for persons to be 6 feet apart. There's no vehicle that can have 6 feet apart, so just to say you do something, you rob them of a passenger to say only two can be on the back seat of the car because we are a government which cares and we're doing something. According to Crawford, such a decision worsens the problem as it causes more people to accumulate at the bus stops which create crowding. He said the bus stops thus become super spreader locations. And we must say nothing because they are the ones in charge. That doesn't make sense, he stated. The opposition senator implored the government to question the efficiency and effectiveness of the measures it enforces before it implements them. They say the worst thing in government is to be accused of not doing anything, so therefore they just do something, he remarked. Crawford pointed out that the research on the situation in Athens, Greece, found that at 6 p.m. instead of 9 p.m. curfew led to a 4.63% relative increase in time spent at home. It had no effect on time spent in groceries and pharmacies. Considering that it was an 18.5% reduction in time, it is not sufficient for a 4.6% increase in time staying home, Crawford noted. What it has done is to now shift people into a crowd when crowd is what should be resisted, he said. So when 7 o'clock comes, everybody is hurrying within the same space and the same time, he added, highlighting that the research showed that early evening curfews lead to more crowding in indoor spaces, which may facilitate the spread of disease. He said intervention should be based on thorough analysis of human behavior that anticipates substitution of activities unlike the curfew. This is what the signs are saying, and one of the things I used to hear early on is trust the signs. The opposition senator pointed to another study out of Germany, which noted that nighttime curfews provide no statistics evidence to show that they were effective in slowing the spread of the pandemic. Crawford charged that the government was sticking to things that have been proven by science not to work, robbing the economy of activity, robbing the people of earning possibilities, robbing the society of all these things which it has been proven that it don't work. If you look at the society, now you realize that nobody no business about the time that you want to set for a curfew. People are out doing their own thing in their own time, he said, arguing that the signs should not be ignored. Crawford asserted that the first lockdown in Jamaica during the first wave of the coronavirus never worked. In fact, it was abandoned by the third week when the spike was still in its height, and then, over time, the spike ended. What we're seeing is that the cost of these curfews, the cost of these lockdowns, are not reflecting the benefit that they're supposed to carry. I will tell you, and I'm telling you now, to tell Prime Minister Holness not to continue telling us when to go to our beds, because it does not, based on science, work. Westmoreland's crime worry. Dissatisfied with the level of violence in Westmoreland, councillors have called for a more permanent solution now that the government can no longer rely on states of public emergencies as a tool to rein in lawbreakers. Westmoreland ended 2019 with 89 murders, and while things improved in 2020 when there were 77 killings, there have been 116 so far this year, according to data provided by the police at Thursday's meeting at the Municipal Corporation. Counselor for the Form Division, Rodolphe Otto, JLP Party, noted that while he has confidence in the effectiveness of the non-discontinued SOEs, he was of the view that the council could play a more robust role in fighting crime. We need to stand up and let our voices be heard. The people of Westmoreland are living in fear. The SOEs made a lot of difference, but we need to do something else, he urged. Councillor for the Leamington Division, Siebert McFarlane, People's National Party, argued that another plan was needed and suggested that the parish would benefit from more police officers in each division. He also raised concern that, according to data presented to the meeting by Deputy Superintendent of Police, DSP in charge of operations in Westmoreland Police Division, a lot of the crimes in the parish were being committed by youngsters. McFarlane called for the government to establish more social agencies to get the youth involved in community activities. The SDC, Social Development Commission, has been around for a while, but we need more for these kind of agencies so that we can organize teenagers. I think that this could be an important part of ridding the society of crime, he said. Commenting on the issue, Councillor Kevin Murray, Friendship Division, JLP, called for a permanent solution to crime. This was something, he said, that the SOEs had been unable to provide. Counsel for the Better Town Division, Henry Delancey, agreed with both his peers. The SOEs are not permanent or sustainable. I think they have served their purpose, but it's not for continuous use. I heard the Prime Minister proposition the other day, and I don't think we need to be so drastic, but I do agree that we need legislative changes for gun crimes, Delancey explained. Speaking at the ruling JLP's annual party conference on November 28, Prime Minister and party leader Andrew Holness expressed his personal view that anyone found in possession of illegal firearms should be given the death penalty. In addition to his comments on Holness' stance, Delancey also agreed with McFarlane's call for a revamp of social agencies. Councillor McFarlane was telling the council the other day how, at one point, Westmoreland had 30 great clubs, and now we have none. I think that youth and sports club need to be reorganized and some new ones need to be formed, he added. In his response to the councillor's comments, Minister of Local Development and Rural Development Desmond McKenzie, who was a guest at the meeting, said there is a misconception that SOEs are the government's only response to crime. I cannot let some of these comments go unanswered. This administration, since 2016, has invested more in the JCF than any government in the last 30 years. We have built more police stations and provide cars. We have increased the intelligence capacity of the police force. So, all that you are seeing played out in the part of the response of the government to crime, he stated. Just this week in Parliament, the legislation was amended to extend stiffer penalties to criminals who are incarcerated, who are creating more havoc in the society from prison, Mackenzie added. Manchester Custos wants toilets for disabled at businesses. Custos of Manchester, Garfield Green, wants all business establishments and public buildings to have sanitary convenience for able-bodied persons and similar facilities specially designed for the use of the disabled. Green, who was a guest speaker at the official opening of the Central Regional Branch of the Office of the Public Defender OPD in Mandeville on Friday, told guests amid applause, "Every business place and every public building, including shopping malls, must have sanitary conveniences, and these facilities must be fully and adequately maintained for the able and disabled." The Custos cited Mandeville, the parish main town, as prime example of a place where basic public amenities were lacking, and suggested that there was insufficient care and concern for the welfare of members of the disabled community. He noted, "Manchester is known to be an affluent parish with lots of well-to-do people, yet," he lamented, "our leaders are unable to provide basic public convenience and services for disabled people, especially here." He went on to list some of the inconvenience endured by the public of Manchester, and in particular, disabled citizens whom, he said, continue to face challenges and sometimes find themselves excluded from mainstream society. He spoke of block sidewalks, unlimited access to public building, and a lack of special transportation or provision for public parking for disabled persons. Public defender Arlene Harrison-Henry, commenting on the OPD's newest addition, said the aim was to bring the services of the Office of the Public Defender closer to the people of the communities. The Mandeville branch, which is located at Shop G10 Annex Plaza at 7 Caledonia Road, will also serve the parishes of Clarendon and St. Elizabeth. Along with the Kingston operations, the OPD also has an office in Montego Bay, St. James. Senior citizen finds joy in foster parenting. Foster parenting often brings about much satisfaction and rewards to persons who opt to provide a safe, loving and nurturing environment for children whose parents may temporarily not be in a situation to provide adequate care for them, particularly for other adults whose children have grown up and have left behind an empty nest at home. Foster parenting often proves to be a mutual benefiting relationship to both adult and child. The experience is relatable to a 69-year-old woman who has fostered 4 children, one of whom still lives with her. Prior to becoming a foster parent, she raised 5 other children, including a niece. "I never regret doing it. I am glad that I am able to help someone. I'm really proud of being a foster mother. It's good to foster," she asserts, adding that those who are able to become a foster parent should do so to help a child in need. The retired school cleaner, who is not a biological mother, disclosed that she gets support from her extended family, who adores her 16-year-old foster son, whom she has been taking care of for the past 11 years. Retired JN executive and former president of the Jamaica National Pensioners Association, Mary Allen Smith, maintains that foster parenting can provide a new lease on life for retirees. "It is always a good thing to give back. You can't do too much for our children. When you see how some children are neglected and you have the ability to help, you try to help. There are, of course, inherent risks, but where arrangements are structured to minimize the risk to retirees and children, it could prove a win-win initiative. The benefits for the children are food, shelter, protection, guidance, stability, and love. And for the retirees, depending on their situation, continuous mental engagement, companionship, ready to access to a hug and a helping hand," she said. Tanika Casanova Durant, placement coordinator with the Child Protection and Family Services Agency, CPFSA, explained that foster parenting is a process that facilitates the placement of a child aged 0 to 18 years in the care of an adult person or couple who are not the biological parents of the child. Requirements for foster parenting. Anyone between the ages of 25 and 65 who is of good moral and legal standing can become a foster parent. Persons over 65 can also become a foster parent if they are still gainfully employed, in good health, and have an excellent support system, Casanova Durant pointed out. We provide counseling and training for prospective foster parents so that they can be informed about how to raise a child successfully and, importantly, to ensure that the child's well-being is safeguarded, she explained. According to Casanova Durant, foster parents should have suitable home accommodation, a steady source of income, and be willing to be supervised by a social worker. One of the things we always advise a foster parent is that they must be willing to allow the child to maintain contact with his or her biological parents or relatives where appropriate. In addition, at the recommendation of the social worker, a child can be reintegrated with his or her family. This, as we believe, that kinship ties should be preserved and the possibility of recommendation for the child to be reintegrated. She also pointed out that bimonthly allowance is provided by the government for the maintenance of each foster child. We recognize that the family is the preferred environment for the children to be raised, and the resource cements the positive outcome that can be realized when children are raised in family-based environments as opposed to residential care. We therefore continue our thrust to have more children benefiting from the foster care program, Casanova Durant said. To become a foster parent, you can submit an application to the Office of the Child Protection and Family Services Agency in your parish. You may also visit the agency's website at childprotection.gov.jm. Please remember to subscribe, like, share, and click the notification bell for daily updates.